I want to begin with some opening remarks concerning just the theme of the renewal or the purpose of the theme, to make known the prominence of God himself in purposing and providing salvation. I'm convinced that we're living in the end times of the Gentiles. By that I mean that I believe that God is going to soon remove the veil from Israel's eyes and turn away ungodliness from Jacob. God is going to receive them again. He is able to graft them in again. He will take away their sin, which thing he has covenanted to do. And the reason I believe this is not far off is because of the gross darkness of the world and the gross iniquity that's covered the earth in our time. Now, the world in general is a sinful place. We know that, and we expect that. We're living in the realm of the prince of the power of the air. This is his dominion where he operates. So we expect the world to be a rebellious, wicked place. But I'm talking now about what we find in the churches. That's why I believe that, see, God's Spirit's not always going to strive with men. He's not going to just let this continue on and on and on. He's going to do something about it because his name and his glory is at stake. And it's gotten pretty dark. It's pretty dark in the churches right now. Now, I know I'm not saying that we're the only ones. God forbid. God is faithful to himself to reserve a remnant for himself all over the world, but it's only a remnant. And God is worthy of more than just a remnant. God's not glorified in smallness and in remnants, so he's going to glorify his name. It's my belief that it's going to be pretty soon. I'm not a date setter, don't get me wrong. The time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. The time has come for God to remember and to visit and to thresh Babylon. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion, for the time to favor her, yea, the set time is come. For thy servants take pleasure in her stones and favor even the dust thereof. So the heathen shall fear the name of the Lord, and all the kings of the earth thy glory. When the Lord shall build up Zion, he shall appear in his glory. Now, the purpose for this year's renewal is to establish once again that God is all in all. This isn't about mankind. I want to especially establish that in my message this evening. This is about God. And my topic, as Brother Gina said, is the gift of God. So my message is to tell you something about God, the one who gives gifts to men. Solomon said, and also that every man should eat and drink and enjoy the good of all his labor, it is the gift of God. Well, aren't you glad that's not my text? Wouldn't be able to talk about that for very long. That's not too deep. Now Solomon sat on the throne of David, his father. God blessed him and gave him a wisdom that no other man had, that his fame went throughout the world. But Solomon didn't know about the gifts that God has given to us in Christ Jesus, the gifts that Paul wrote about. Now, what God is doing is glorifying his name, and he's doing this by revealing himself to his creatures, and particularly those in heaven. God can only be glorified to the extent that he has been revealed. So the people of God are on display so that more of God can be known. We are a spectacle unto angels, but unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church or through the church, the manifold witness of God. So really, God's not even primarily revealing himself to us. Although we're getting to see him, aren't we? Primarily, though, we are the vehicles for his revelation to the principalities and powers in heavenly places. What God is doing is glorifying his name. And he's revealed himself by what he is doing in the earth, which is working salvation in the midst of the earth. Now, what God is revealing would not otherwise be known. Not by the angels, not by any other creatures. He's got to reveal this. God can tell you some things by speaking to you. We can transfer information to one another by telling each other, but there are some things that have got to be seen. And I don't mean just with the eyes, I mean it's got to be worked out. You got to see somebody work to really know them. And God is, he's working salvation in the earth, and this is how he's revealing himself. When Satan rebelled in heaven, those angels who retained their holiness learned some things about God as they beheld Satan fall from heaven. They learned about how God handles rebellion. When they witnessed God create the universe in 6 days, they learned some more things about their Creator. They were there before the throne of heaven, faithfully serving God in the capacities that he made them for, but there is much about God that they did not and could not know unless God continued in some kind of revelatory work. So he has to be seen in what he's doing, and he's revealing his graciousness, his kindness, his goodness, his mercy, his righteousness, his long suffering, his not only his righteousness, but his ability to give righteousness. This is where we come in. This is how God's revealing all this. How else is it going to be known? He didn't get to see that in Satan when he fell. He's revealing these things about himself through us, through the church. Now, God has some, what I'm going to call, outcome. There's an outcome that God's already determined. Like, there's no chance of this being altered. There's no possibility of this not coming to pass. This has already been very well brought out in previous messages. God has determined things. Now, there's these three different views from Scripture of what God has determined. From one view, the outcome of the present divine project has been revealed that from the race of fallen mankind, God is going to redeem a people for himself, and they are going to be formed into a holy temple in which God can dwell in his fullness. Now that's, I'm talking about without limit, in his fullness, in all his glory forever and ever. This temple, that's his people. We're not talking about a building. We're talking about him forming a people in which he can present himself and dwell in the fullness of himself in this people, unhindered, unopposed, and unabated. Now, that's just one point of view. Now, from another point of view, God's making a people ready to be the bride of his Christ, his Lamb. The glorified Son of Man should not be alone in heaven. Therefore, God is preparing him a bride. These two, Christ and his church, will be joined together in blessed union, a true union of likeness and fellowship forever. And now from a third perspective, God and Christ are bringing children for themselves to glory. Children who are going to be inheritors of all things. We are co-heirs together with Christ. Then the inheritance is everything. Everything that God has, we don't even know, the half hasn't been told yet. There's going to be a new heavens, a new earth. We know we're going to reign with Christ and rule over the nations. What all that entails, we don't know, but it's all ours. Amen. Not bad. Now, those are three views. If you know your scripture, you know this is from scripture, that this is kind of three different views of what God has determined. This is what's going to happen. This is going to be the outcome of this project. Now, here's what God started with. This is all marvelous news, of course. And you know there's a lot more details involved in what I'm talking about. That's what all these different messages are about the details, because the revelation of God is in the details of this. We have to consider what God started with. He started with a race that he created, but that was ignorant of him, sinned against him, and was thus alienated from him. Sin brought a curse upon the entire race, which resulted in continual sinking further and further into the depths of rebellion against God. Whatever God had revealed in the natural creation was not seen and was not understood by man, his highest creation on earth. They didn't even see it. Men continually digress farther away from God, growing less and less like him, dominated by the devil, who is the chief rebel and liar. God then formed the nation of Israel and gave them much more than he gave the rest of humanity. They received God's personal favor, and he put his love upon them. He delivered them from their enemies. He gave them the promises and the holy prophets and the covenants and the fathers and even more than that. Yet they, being the very best of mankind, and they are the very best of mankind, were stiff-necked and rebelled at his word, broke his covenant, killed his prophets, and murdered his only son sent from heaven. Now that's what the best of humanity did. And the Gentiles were even worse. And I want to pause for a minute and expound that. The Jews are the best of humanity. Now before, there's a worldwide hatred of the Jews. That's because there's a worldwide hatred of God. People are always wondering why. Jews are wondering why. It's because the world hates God. That's why. But now the Jews were the best of mankind. God prepared them. And you know, if you think about this, you might, some ignorant Gentiles might think, well, if Christ would have come to us, we wouldn't have killed him. Oh, really? What was it that Herod did? All the baby Jew boys from 2 years old and under, kill them. There's the Gentile reception of the Christ. They didn't even want him to live to 2 years old. At least the Jews let him live to 33. There's what the Gentiles did. So the Jews are the best of humanity. God made them so. But he did this now to demonstrate something. The Gentiles sunk further and further downward, worshiping anything but God. They were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in the world, and did not even recognize, God didn't even recognize them as a people. God knows what's in the heart of every man. So if I can kind of speak poetically here, beginning with Adam, he scoured the earth for a man or men that would, looking for someone who retained the good thing that he created, looking for a candidate who could represent him and bring glory and honor to his name, someone who could fulfill this role that he had determined, looking for anyone through whom he could shine his glory and reveal to the heavenly host those many unknown things about himself. And here's what he found. Both Jews and Gentiles, that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Now, if you begin a business, after a certain amount of time, you expect the business to make a profit. A business that doesn't make profit is a completely pointless business. What do you do with an enterprise that's unprofitable? You close it down. Stop the bleeding. Cut your losses. Close the business down because it's not making any money. A creation that does not serve and glorify its creator is pointless. What do you do with the creation that's unprofitable, that cannot serve its creator, that is corrupt and a misrepresentation of the creator? God gave gifts to men. Now the holy angels are watching this. They're learning something when God gives gifts to this race of men. Again, of course, there are a lot of details involved in God giving gifts to men, and those details are declared in the gospel. The heavenly host witnessed God create the heavens and the earth, and they marveled at what he could do with his word, but now they're getting to behold him work salvation in the earth in divine wisdom. Now, I want to define a gift, and gift The gift that we're talking about here is only defined in the gospel properly. You can't make it from earth to heaven as Adam, one of Adam's race. You can't get there from here unless God gives you some gifts. You can't make it from enemies and aliens to pillars in the temple of God without some gifts. You can't get from here to there without God's gifts. And when they consider the gifts that God gives to men, now the principalities and powers in heavenly places are beginning to see more about God. Now, when we think about the gifts of God, we can't think of it in terms of everyday usage of the word, like birthday gifts or Christmas gifts or wedding gifts. Men give gifts to each other that, frankly, usually are not really, they don't really serve any purpose. Now, someone may present a gift to another person to show their esteem or appreciation of that person, but usually the gift that's given is really, it's of no use. You know, it's appreciated, don't get me wrong, and I'm not saying it's wrong to give gifts to one another, but you've got to wipe all that out of your mind when we talk about this gift, because it's not like that at all. Not in the slightest. This is a different, this gift is defined in the gospel. First, to comprehend the gift of God, we have to understand the state of the recipients. In order for God to use men to be his temple and to be the bride of Christ, to be heirs with Christ, to reign in the world to come, he has some strict requirements that must be met. These people are going to have to are going to have him as their reward and collectively shine the fullness of his glory from their persons. So to do that, the people have got to be like him. That is an absolute requirement. What God is giving as gifts, then, are the things that he himself requires. Even if Adam had not sinned, mankind would not have been prepared to enter the world to come. Yet Adam did sin, which greatly complicated the matter. Adam's race is completely unable to obtain what God requires of them. The only way for us to get those things is if God gives them to us. If we are to reign with Christ, God requires certain things of us. In order to overcome the world and pass the judgment, in order to gain heaven and avoid the lake of fire, the things God requires are absolute necessities. And he knows, because he is the judge, the righteous judge. But we can't earn them. We can't buy them. You can't beg and plead for them and convince God to give them to you. You can't inherit it from your relatives. You can't get it from any other man or any other group of men. You can't get these things. You can't earn it by, you have no merit to earn these things. That's the kind of gift we're talking about. God, we're talking about a matter of heaven or the lake of fire. Life or death. And you need this to avoid death and the lake of fire, but you can't get it by any means. God just gives it. Of course, we're going to get to, there's some details involved in God giving it, but that's the kind of gift we're talking about. We should also understand that God is under no obligation to save us. Now, because of Christ, he has the means to save us, and he has the desire to save us and save to the uttermost. But he is not under obligation to save us, except that he said he would. Glory be to God that he desires to save us. God is a gift giver. Amen. Now, this is what he has revealed about himself. God's gifts are also defined by the manner in which they are given, which is willingly, freely, abundantly. God is blessed to be able to bless. But all of this is because of the merit of another, which is Jesus Christ, the intercessor. Amen. All God's gifts to the redeemed have been earned and purchased by Christ. He made God able to bless you in turning every one of you away from your sins. Amen. And again, I emphasize, what he is giving is what he requires, which should turn our attention to him and not ourselves. No one else does this. For example, if you were If you were looking for employment as an engineer and you see an advertisement, a company was hiring an engineer, well, you can't, if you're not an engineer, then you might as well not even apply because that's what they're looking for. And they're not going to take you if you're not an engineer. You've got to work all that out before you apply for the job. You've got to work out going to college and paying for college and passing the exams and getting your certificates and your diploma. You work all that out yourself first, then you can apply for the engineering job. That's not what God's doing. God's doing the entire work from start to finish. He's making you what he requires you to be through Jesus Christ. Christ has earned, Christ paid for God to do all this to us, for us. He's giving what he requires. Here's what God does. Now, of him, to him, and through him are all things. He begins with Adam's race of condemned sinners. He suffers long while sin grows in the earth. He gives his law to show how exceedingly sinful men really are. He suffers longer while proving that all men are under sin and not capable of keeping the law. Then in due time, he gave his only begotten Son to bear all our sins in his body and to be the sacrifice for the sins of our race once for all. God pours out his wrath and displeasure on his own Son instead of destroying the race of man so that the price can be paid and atonement made. God himself made the way for his wrath against men to be appeased. His righteousness, his justice, his holiness were all satisfied in Christ Jesus. But that's not the end of it. The Father raises his Lamb from the dead and receives him again in heaven, where he's seated at his right hand to rule and reign over the entire project to save everyone that God has chosen. From there, Jesus serves the Father by reigning and interceding on the behalf of mankind. He prepares the hearts of men to receive the gospel. He sends someone to preach the gospel. He grants faith to the hearers. He grants repentance. He gives them to believe. God does the operating in baptism, burying them with Christ, raising them with Christ, giving them new life. He seats us with Christ in heavenly places. He conforms us to the image of Christ. In Christ Jesus, God is transforming men into the very vessels that he requires in the world to come. God says to us, don't sin, resist the devil. And then he gives us the way of escape from every temptation and tells us, I know how to deliver the godly from temptations. And he keeps us from temptations that are too great for us to bear. Jesus said, ye must be born again. You can't do that yourself. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. The charge has been given to the saints to fight the good fight of faith, but it is God himself that has equipped us with the armor of light and the armor of righteousness, our loins girt with truth, the breastplate of righteousness, our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, and prayer and supplications. Jesus gives promises only to those who overcome the world. Yet he tells us, be of good cheer. Amen. I'll inject, already overcome the world. Amen. Having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing them over in it. So because of him, we're fighting against an enemy that's already been defeated. And we could go on and on with examples like this, how that God, this whole work is God's. He's working in you both to do and to will of his good pleasure. To will and to do. In the end, all of heaven is going to be saying, Alleluia! Salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. Salvation is of the Lord. God gave us everything he required. He gave gifts to his people. Another way of saying the same thing is, for by grace are ye saved, by faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. They wonder which is the gift, being saved, grace, or faith? All of it. For it is God which worketh in you. I want to talk about the scriptures use both of these words, gift and gifts. And I do want to get around to looking at one specific gift. Jesus said to the woman at the well in Samaria, if thou knewest the gift of God. And there is the gift of the Holy Ghost and the gift of righteousness. My main text, Romans 6:23, is the gift of God is eternal life. And we already read from Ephesians 2:8, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. But gifts are also spoken of in plural form, for the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now obviously God is not stingy. Every one of these gifts is marvelous, inexhaustible, and worthy of our most profound meditations and discussions. But I'm going to try to limit this to just one gift. Again, Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, probably most of us here have heard someone preach the gospel from this text. Paul is making one of these kind of signatures of the Apostle Paul is to make these contrasts between death and life and wages and the gift. So there's something that we earned by our very nature. We earned death. We earned those wages. God has every right to condemn the entire human race outright. No angel in heaven would accuse him of being unrighteous in this. This would be completely righteous. God was very gentle to Adam and Eve. Have you ever thought about that? Considering what had transpired, the ramifications of what transpired there in the garden, just the entire creation was cursed. You think that didn't make God angry? He was so gentle with Adam and Eve. Long-suffering. So Paul's making this contrast here between wages and the gift. It must also be known that all who refuse God's gracious gift are bound to receive the wages for their sin. But God has given the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And really, Jesus Christ himself is the greatest gift. Really, this is like everything else falls under the heading of him being the gift. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. He gave us Jesus. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? He already gave us the best. He gave himself. He gave us deity. Now, several separate gifts of God are named in Scripture, but all of them are in Christ Jesus, and absolutely none of them can be had without honoring him. It was the atonement in his blood that made it possible for God to do all the necessary work in men in preparation for the world to come. It's because Jesus removed our sin from the presence of God that God is blessing us with these gifts. God is happy because of what Jesus has done for him. With sin being dealt with in righteousness, believing people are now eligible for all of God's gifts. And the gifts are given so that God can be glorified in the people he has chosen throughout all eternity, just as he has purposed. So Jesus gave himself for God. And really, I never considered it this way before, but think about this. Jesus gave himself as a gift to God too. In the same definition, there was no other way. God's Lamb gave himself as a gift to the Father. God gave him as a gift to us. Amen. So when we speak of God's gifts being given to men, this is not being done indiscriminately. Now, I'm not talking about, you know, how they toss out candy at the parade. You just grab a handful and they just wing it out to the crowd. God's not doing that. there's this matter of Jesus Christ, his son. All the gifts are through him. That all men should honor the son, even as they honor the father. He that honoreth not the son, honoreth not the father which hath sent him. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. God gives life because that is what is needed. God's purpose requires that his redeemed ones have eternal life. Sinners, flesh and blood, mortals, dead or dying people have no place in the world to come. All of that stuff is temporal. Everyone inhabiting the world to come has to be specially fitted for it. And that's why there's the resurrection of the dead, in which we'll receive glorious bodies like unto his glorious body. But eternal life is also required in the present time to prepare us for the judgment in the world to come. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die, and whosoever believes in him hath eternal life. That's in the present tense. So I want to take a few moments to define eternal life. And if you've ever tried to define it, you know it's not very easy. And we're not talking about just existence forever. It's a lot more than that. The carnal definition is just living forever, which when people talk about eternal life or living forever, I'm talking about carnal people, they're just talking about more of the same old stuff. They're just like a pig in the mud. They just want more mud, you know, more of this filth. That's eternal life to them, just the same old junk over and over again. But that's not what Jesus and the apostles spoke of. Amen. We're not talking about living in the flesh forever. If you want to have a proper understanding of eternal life, of course, you have to go to the scriptures. And really, eternal life is like an umbrella term that covers a lot of things, as we'll see. Everything that God has given us through Jesus Christ can be summed up in this term, eternal life. There's a common saying among people of the world on the occasions that they're enjoying life in this world, they say, this is really living. I work at the airport, and when the weather's like around the 70s and there's no wind and there's no clouds in the sky and it's blue, and the pilots like to go up and they say, this is really living. This is it. Or to some people, if they're out in the boat on the lake and the weather's nice and they're fishing and swimming and whatever and just relaxing, they say, this is really living. Or some people, if it's they've got all the family and friends over to the house and they've got a table set with all kinds of sumptuous fare and good food and family, and this is really living. But that's not the kind of thing we're talking about. Not at all. When a person's in a coma, paralyzed, unresponsive to any kind of stimulation, what do people say? They say, they're not really living. So there is, even though these things have nothing to do with eternal life, there is some truth to this concept that life has to do with experience in addition to existence. And eternal life is not just eternal existence. Eternal life is fellowship with God, having the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, having the righteousness of God, having a way of escape from every temptation, having our lives hid with Christ in God, being seated with Christ in heavenly places. We are come to Mount Zion, having an intercessor in heaven always before the throne of God in our behalf. We can pray to God and others pray for us. God gives us grace in abundance, whereby we are made sufficient for all things. And we are edifying to saints, and other saints are edifying to us. We are being conformed to the image of Christ. We can resist the devil. We're part of the whole family of God in heaven and earth. We have the mind of Christ. We were buried with Christ and raised with Christ, given to suffer with Christ and to reign with him. We have escaped the world and are overcoming the world. We are looking and watching for Jesus' soon return, at which time we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We actually look forward to the judgment. We're going to reign forever and ever and rule the nations and see the face of God. We're going to serve him and show forth his glory in a holy temple. Now this is really living. This is eternal life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. How can eternal life be manifested? John said, we saw that eternal life, and the eternal life was with the Father. Well, of course, he's talking about Jesus Christ. That is the eternal life. And we know that the Son of God has come and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. The eternal life given as a gift to us is knowing him and being in him. So we're not talking about mere existence. Eternal life is having fellowship and communion with the very source of life. To some extent, we are presently like him, and we shall be the more like him. How else could we have fellowship with God? There is no other way for man to gain eternal life except in Jesus Christ, who is the life. God chose us, gave us faith, sent us preachers, gave us to believe, buried us with Christ, and raised us with him, having forgiven us all our sins. God's own Lamb, that eternal life, which was with the Father, that is deity, paid the awful price for the gifts God has given us. The cross, the agony, being made sin, being made a curse, being bruised and being put to grief by the Father, his shameful and humiliating death, all these are the price for the gifts God gave to us. Now, a final word I thought necessary to address this. And this is really the reason for this year's renewal, I believe, is that when people hear part of the gospel, and perhaps it's not proclaimed like it should, the attention gets drawn to us instead to him. So now there's a way, people can hear all these wonderful things and hear about the gift of God and the gifts of God and think, well, God must love me quite a bit. He's willing to do just about anything for me. And we hear this, we hear a lot of this kind of thing coming out of the churches these days. But it's not about us. God is revealing himself in what he is doing through us. So it's not of him that willeth nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. In salvation, God is revealing who he is. The angels aren't as fascinated with men as they are with God. This gospel project did not begin with the consideration of the needs of humanity. We are but some of his innumerable creatures. God is not motivated by what happens on earth. He's the one making it happen. David rightly said, "When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visitest him." David came to this conclusion without the Hubble telescope and without the Voyager satellite and without the Mars rover. If God can make the vast, beautiful, orderly, powerful, faithful heavens with just a word, why is he even merciful to man? Because he's revealing himself through us, through the church specifically. He's making us into what he requires so that his name will be glorified. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea and all that are in them, heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. Thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. Amen. Amen.